Hey, Viola, I have a patient who just disclosed to me that they have a cancer diagnosis, and now they want to get all of their dentistry done before they move forward with treatment. What do I do for them?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
All the time. We see our patients, we sit them down, we ask them if there's any changes in their medical history, and oftentimes they say no and we move on with our day. Sometimes they say yes, and that change is quite serious. Sometimes it's a cancer diagnosis. And now all of a sudden, we have to obviously share, you know, some semblance of empathy and concern for them and their health, but then we have to kind of put our dental hat back on and figure out how to keep that patient as healthy as we can before, during, and after they receive treatment. Do you have any suggestions?
Well, I have to tell you, Pam, this is something that I talk a lot about when I teach my dental hygiene students and my dental students about what to do with patients who are recently diagnosed with cancer. And the guideline is specifically that we make sure the patient, before they visit the oncologist, before they start chemotherapy, that they need to come see us, because we need to make sure that we're doing everything we can to clean up, if you will, right? To remove teeth that are marginal, to make sure that we have good oral health, and give them instructions for scrupulous oral health care and hygiene at home. Because if anything is going to keep a patient from taking their chemotherapy, it's going to be the effects in the mouth. Now, it could be everything from tooth movement, which is possible, up to and including the dreaded mucositis, which is where a reason why a lot of people stop taking their chemotherapy and ultimately, unfortunately, pass away sooner than they would have, simply because mucositis is so horrendous. They don't want to take any more chemotherapy because they're afraid of getting it again. We can eliminate a lot of that by you know, instituting good practices in advance of them starting chemotherapy. Do this every day. Do frequent recalls to make sure they're following up and we're following up. But at the end of the day, this is what we recommend in dentistry. It's not always possible. And a lot of oncologists don't know this. The patient is anxious to start, and the oncologist is just as anxious to get them started.
Most definitely, yes. And obviously, we seem to have this conversation almost reactively. I don't generally tell my healthy patients, hey, if you ever find out you have cancer, come see me first. I mean, that's not really a conversation that we have. And oftentimes we're behind the eight ball, or we're, you know, after the diagnosis has taken place. I agree with you. We cannot stress preventive dentistry more strongly at this time. And so I know I've shared this before. I'm more than happy to share it again. I have a whole email that I send my patients that have specifically head and neck cancer, where they're going to receive radiation up in the head and neck region, on how we're going to keep them healthy. But keeping them on a really strict recall, being mindful of the fact that oral disease is, you know, biofilm mediated, and doing everything we can to disrupt that biofilm and keep it at bay. Also getting them on a strong preventive regimen, and knowing if they're going to undergo chemotherapy or head and neck radiation, we have to hit them with every preventive product we pretty much know, just so we can keep them healthy, but also in some instances, palliatively, to keep them comfortable during that time, especially if they do experience any sort of mucositis.
Well, keep in mind also, Pam, as a product of the post-pandemic world we live in now, you know, waiting times for appointments in dental offices can be significant. Even though we want very much to get a patient who's newly diagnosed with cancer in our office as quickly as possible, sometimes that sort of flies under the radar. We kind of miss it, and we'll give somebody an appointment that's, let's say, 2 months out, and then they don't want to wait 2 months to start their chemo. So we got to also train our support staff and say, when it's a newly diagnosed case of cancer, we've got to get them in right away. We've got to make time in our appointment schedule if we can, because at the end of the day, we need to make sure that they're being treated as quickly as they can so they can start their chemo.
Most definitely. So we got to get them as healthy, get their oral condition nice and stable so that they can go into this treatment at least as dentally healthy as they can. So I think this is really, really great advice. Any final thoughts?
Yep. I would tell you that, remember that chemotherapy agents work by stopping mitotic rates. So cells that are rapidly mitotic or divide rapidly are common targets for chemotherapy agents, because that's what cancer is. Cancer is cells that are typically normal, but have lost the ability to control their own mitosis. And so the mitosis occurs at a very rapid rate, almost too rapid for the tissue. Well, that's our marker. When we find cells in the body that have a high mitotic rate, we can assume that that's a candidate for cancer. So the drugs we use to treat cancer affect cells that have a high mitotic rate, which is great, except that some cells in the body are naturally rapidly dividing or highly mitotic. And that includes the cells in the oral cavity that make up the lining of the cavity and the tissues in the oral cavity. So that's why chemotherapy has direct results on the oral cavity, because we're attacking cells that have that high mitotic rate. Same reason why people have their hair sometimes fall out, because again, hair follicles are rapidly dividing as well. So keep that in mind, that it's necessarily the intent of the drug, but also a known side effect of the drug. And that's why it's really important, as you said, to have those tight recall schedules, because things can change in the mouth rapidly.
I haven't had somebody take me up on it yet, but I always make myself available to my patient and also to their oncologist so that I can be part of the team and really, you know, help them throughout this entire process. So thank you for that. I don't know how much, I mean, there's just such, it's really hard because obviously it depends on where their cancer is in their body, how it's going to be treated, what the duration of their care is going to be. But I think, just like you've shared in a previous video, being there for them is also incredibly important, and being, you know, not a source of pity or so sorry, but also to be somebody there to support them and cheer for them. I think patients really appreciate that.
Words of encouragement, and not just necessarily for the patient, but also the person who's in charge of their care. As their cancer progresses, they may have a full-time caregiver. It's important to support that person as well, because they share that emotional burden.
Agreed. So I think that this was really great advice. And I think that we as dental professionals have such an amazing opportunity to change our patients' lives and the lives of the people that our patients love. So this was a great medical history mystery. I can't wait to see you again and do this again.
Same here, Pam. Thanks so much.
Thank you, everybody. We will see you next time. Thank you.